What's up, Red Dreaded Nation? Akasan here. Let me know that you guys can hear us, that we're live, that we are coming into your goddamn vaginal ear holes. That's what I need to know. It says the Last of Us Part 2 discussion, people. Let me know. Hype in the chat. We're using a new thing called StreamYard. No audio problems, I hope. I hope I couldn't do any beautiful music or no sound effects and no John Campia screaming, pick up a fucking dumbbell. But I want to know that you guys are good to Oh, that's cool. Oh, I could actually do that. Okay. But anyways.
You can make the whole show about you, Oxford.
That's what the plan was. That's what the plan was. All right. Actually, let me, can I do that? No, I can't. Let's go ahead and get into it. It is my honor to introduce, first and foremost, we're gonna go under me. It's like the Brady Bunch. You guys know her as the person I always mention when I finish, exactly, when I finish my stream, and if I finish my stream early, and you guys want to, you don't care about the game she's playing, you just want to see her and things like that, because whatever the case may
Being
be, and we're
perfect.
all we're always off, we're always off on whatever game. But it is my honor to introduce Mai, or Maichu, call her what you want.
Hello.
Welcome to the channel, welcome to the show. How you doing?
I am doing very well.
Great, great. I love your red and black microphone. I don't think I've ever seen that
That is
before.
really dope.
Ah,
Yeah,
thank you.
red and black.
It is the HyperX Quadcast. I can tap to mute it.
What?
Wow.
Holy shit.
Technology.
Okay. Cool. All right. Well, keep it on mute the whole stream. We appreciate
Rude.
it.
Wait, no. I was like, that was a Drew. Get
All right.
rid
Well, first of all, and then she loved The Last of Us, so we're
of
good with that. She was
Boom.
afraid she might start crying on the stream,
I
but
know. Just
yeah,
from talking about it makes
just
me.
from talking about. Then after that, it is of course my longtime reactor friend, brother from another reactor mother.
Which one are you talking about?
Me, obviously.
Yeah, there's two of us out here.
I'm talking about the Reactastic Four, the formerly known as the Big Four, now formerly known as Ryan Wright, now known as Greg Alba of the one half of the Real Rejects, which is actually a little bit more. Greg Alba, what's going on, brother?
Hi, Akasan.
Hey, buddy. Long time no see.
Long time no see.
I've missed you.
I'm
I
trying to
love
provide the best kind of intro energy for you right now.
It's working.
As you're doing
You're
it,
matching.
this is good live stream energy, right?
Yeah, you're matching the tone of the channel. This is
Oh.
exactly how people see my reaction. So I appreciate that.
I'm
Yeah.
excited to talk about this game. I love talking about this game. I'm not sick of defending this game already. As much as I want to believe this is the last time we will be talking about The Last of Us 2, I know someone's going to corner me into a conversation.
Yep.
I already got someone on Facebook who I've never met sent me like eight audio messages telling me why I'm wrong. I was like, I'm not going to listen to this. This is ridiculous. So I'm gonna be, let's be calm today. Let's be calm. Let's be
All
calm.
right, my brother. All right.
Until Drew starts talking. Until Drew starts.
Speaking of which, speaking of angry black in their no, angry black men. Surprisingly, the one person that did not like this game, but it is my honor to have him on this panel to intelligently discuss as to why he didn't like it. Because this is a very rare thing. I think a lot of people don't understand this. Drew dislikes nothing. I can't, like,
Really?
he dislikes nothing. I
Really?
remember we had an argument about how classic of a movie Venom was at New York Comic Con, and I was like, I'm about to kick this motherfucker out, because this dude does not dislike anything. So I was surprised and shocked to find out that after beating The Last of Us, he was like, well, that's that, uninstall, because he couldn't break the disc. He just uninstalled it and ended the stream, and then proceeded to rant about the game for 10 hours, two times on stream,
Two
mind
10-hour streams.
you. Drew.
You ranted for, on it for 2 10-hour streams, so for 20 hours total, you complained?
Yeah.
That is a strong hate.
I wish I had your mentality, Drew. I wish I thought the way you thought.
I do too. I wish.
How you doing?
You thought like me. I'm doing pretty good. I'm excited to talk about this game that I've been talking about for like what feels like a month. It won't stop. It won't stop. It just won't stop.
Yeah.
But I'm glad to be here. I'm glad to be here.
Thank you for coming. And Drew is now currently in where? Philadelphia?
Right now? Philadelphia temporarily until I go back to
LA. Still in Philly. Yeah, right.
Wait, this isn't fair, though. Drew is the only one who does. I mean, I love the feeling that I don't have to really fight to defend this game. But that's what I was really apprehensive about. But now I feel kind of bad for Drew.
Yeah. How you think I just found out that all y'all like it. I thought at least she would not like it, but she likes it.
I thought it'd be like an even number.
I thought it was great.
God damn. No,
You don't worry. Don't worry, because Drew has the internet on his side.
Don't worry. I'll change my opinion today, Drew. I'll change it just to back you up, dude.
No, you won't. No, you won't.
Yeah, I will. Okay. Yeah. Drew, Abby sucks. Yeah.
I'm not going to lie. It was hard. It was really hard to find somebody in my particular circle that hated the game. So when I found out that Drew didn't like it, I was like, dude, we got to have this talk. Yeah. Because the last stream that I had, the only person that could argue that the game was bad was somebody that watched D-Pity, a friend of mine, stream the game. And so he didn't actually play the game. He just watched the stream. And so he was making arguments based upon other people's intent. So I guess first and foremost, is it safe to say that in our own respective circles, was everybody generally in agreement about the game? So, for example, everybody around me loved the game. But with Drew, for you, for the most part, it seemed every time I jump on your stream, it's, you know, somebody made a $10, $20 donation yesterday to you. And or was it a $250? Yeah. It was a $250 donation. And they were like, hey, Drew, I just want to say I appreciate everything, blah, blah, blah. Oh, P.S. Fuck Abby. Like that. So in your circle, where do you feel the majority of the favoritism is?
I've only talked to 3 people in my circle that actually like the game. Everyone else can't stand it.
Wow. Okay. I'm curious about that. Mai?
To be honest, as we have been in lockdown here in California, I haven't talked to too many people that have played the game. Because it was just me locked in a basement, aka my house, and just playing it for 2 weeks. So I really haven't talked to anyone since I finished the game like 2 or 3 days ago.
How many hours did it take you to beat the game?
God, I think 60.
Oh, wow. That's a long
time. Really?
That's a good amount of time.
Because
damn.
I am a person of patience. Like, even though I was only playing on normal mode, I tried to use as little ammo as possible. I tried to
good.
Do super stealthy. So
you do the stealth. Hell yeah.
And I have the patience of a god. I will sit there in a corner and just be like, it's fine. I'll just watch all of the enemy movement and then plan of attack and then go in.
Good.
Oh, nice.
Good.
Very good call.
I like
it. Drew and I approve of the way
you play. Yeah, we do. Yeah.
I don't like blazing because I don't like confrontation. I get scared and then I run away.
Yeah, I know the feeling. I get scared too. I'm not good at like Resident Evil. Like that game scares the crap out of me. Yeah,
I agree.
No, like when you encounter the Rat King in the game, I was like terrified. I had to realize like I can't beat. I'm not beating this because I'm too scared. And I need to realize this is just a video game and I could beat this. So I go through like a whole emotional process when I encounter certain levels in that game.
Greg, how about your circle? Like, what has your experience been with this game and the people around you?
Well, I mean, the people around, I think, I don't know. I feel like you kind of attract who you are. So you're naturally going to, if you like the game, it's thinking like maybe on the internet, you're not going to find your opinion all that valid. In Drew's case, he's going to be totally valid. But I think in real life, your inner circle or whatever, if they all play the game, I feel like you'll most likely attract those who are on the similar page as you. So in my core and like on a deep philosophical law of attraction level, yeah, I think that everyone I've talked to who has played the game does love the game. And we really, yeah, I would say, in person or on the phone, people I've talked to, they love the game. But
okay.
On the internet, you know, woke culture is ruining everything or some shit like that. Yeah. Yeah.
Now, did you guys actually feel that? That's a good point. Did you guys feel that it was a woke game as the leaks were suggesting? And actually, how many people knew about the leaks in detail before playing the game? So nobody knew ahead of time.
One of the reasons why I'm so pissed off is because I enacted secret security level protocols to avoid all leaks and spoilers and everything. Like, I blocked everything out, and I had to try so hard to do it because I would stream and people would come into the stream and just randomly try to spoil everything. So I had my moderators working overtime, and I'm like, I gotta train my eyes to only look at certain things. I'm like, Jesus. So I actively avoided every spoiler, every single one. So I went into the game completely blind, luckily.
That's it turned out great for you.
Yeah, it did. They rewarded me for it.
I was told before playing the game was that here's how it was told to me. Abby kills Joel, and then you play as Ellie, who's on a revenge quest, and then halfway through the game, you play as Abby. Now, the issue with how that was pitched to me was it sounded like a linear version of playing the game. It sounded like you would play as Ellie, and then halfway through, the story would continue in that timeline, and then you would suddenly switch to Abby. When I was playing the game, I was pleasantly surprised to be like, oh, we're going back to Seattle day one and watching the timeline of day one, two, and three from Abby's perspective. Because initially in that leak, I was like, that sounds like a kind of a frustrating experience. But when you play, I think when you go back in time and you're playing the Abby perspective of Seattle day one, two, and three, that's a lot different than going to Seattle day four as Abby after playing day one, two, and three as Ellie. But yeah, I mean, like when Joel first died, I did a post about it. I hated it. I was like mad at the game. Yep. And then I was like, this is some manipulative bullshit. And then by the time I got to but it was like a while into the game, and suddenly I started loving it. And then by the time I got to the final moment, I think a big issue is, and I'm curious to hear what Drew has to say. So I could tell him why he's wrong. No, I'm just joking. I'll hear you. It's one of these games. It's rare where I come across a story where I'm like, I could tell if you don't like it, I totally get it. And so I can't fault someone for not liking it, because it comes down to a simple fact of, if you can't get on board with Abby, there's just no chance in hell you'll enjoy this game. And it took me a while to get on board with Abby, but I eventually was fortunate enough to get on board with Abby. But I completely understand if you can't.
Do you mind telling people what moment that was? Because I know what it was for you, but I want everybody to know exactly where that was.
I mean, I was getting the perspective. I think the issue that comes down, I don't know. I mean, Drew, with you,
What I meant was the exact moment, as far as I remember, I watched your discussion about it, and it was when.
The moment I was already getting on board with Abby when she was playing, like when she's protecting Levi and Yara.
Yeah.
It was the moment I realized I loved Abby. When I was it was at that point I was like, okay, I she's cool, I like her. But when I loved her was when my girlfriend's wife got tied in, so I was thinking when Lev says like those were your people after Abby protected Lev, and then Abby turns and goes, you're my people, and it's like this subconscious just instinctual answer. It's not like she's thinking about it, she just lets it out. And that's when I don't know, it's an arc, and I don't think you need to forgive her. I think that's the thing, is some people think they might need to forgive her for what she did to Joel. I don't think it's about, you know, like you need to let that go. I think you're allowed to be angry about that, but you can still get to a point where you can understand or have some perspective or get on her perspective train. So yeah, that's basically it. Yeah. I want to let other people talk too. So yeah.
Would you feel that was also, do you agree with what Greg is saying about you needed to basically get on board with Abby or you're going to hate this game? Because Deep Pity said something the same. He said almost exactly the same thing, was Abby was basically a make or break for this game. Would you agree?
long
no.
story. So while I love the game, I still absolutely hate Abby.
Yes.
Oh, fascinating. Interesting.
So what I liked about the game is that even though we did have to play as Abby and there were so many other aspects of it, I like the fact that you kind of got to see everything through her point of view, right? So you got to see, you know, her thought basis behind things and everything. But at the same time, every time I would die as Abby, I felt my heart just burst into love every time that I saw her die. I was like, wow, this is great.
Fascinating.
Yes.
I absolutely hate Abby. Like, even when
when Greg
had mentioned, like, oh, that moment when, you know, she had this really great moments with like Lev and really great moments with Yara, like, I liked Lev and Yara just fine, but in the end, had it ended with killing Lev and killing Abby, I would have been absolutely fine with it. But I see the reason why they chose the ending that they did. And I honestly don't think all video games need a happy ending. I mean, everyone is sitting there saying, I wish that she had just killed him, but or killed her. But I see from the other perspective where it's like she did it so she can have closure, right? She didn't want to keep this infinite loop of revenge. Exactly. So then she ended it so that way she can find happiness in the end, right? Because otherwise, if she did that, then Lev lived, then Lev would have come for her. She would have never been happy, right?
So from what I'm gathering from what you're saying is that even though you couldn't, because the other thing I was telling people was even if you don't end up liking Abby, if you can at least while you're playing as her kind of get the perspective and understand what the game is going for. And the themes and all that and the whatever additional nuance that the game is aiming for, then you, because I don't think you have to get on board with loving her or even necessarily liking her, but at least getting where she's come. It's kind of like when, you know, like there's a villain in a movie, but you don't need to, like, I don't love Thanos, the character, like the being, the person, but I get where he's coming from in a lot of ways, you know, like, that kind of thing, you know. Okay, I get you.
Yeah, exactly. Like, there's two sides to every story. You know, every evil person has some sort of backstory behind them, right? So being able to see, like, okay, like, this is the pain that she went through. I was actually riveted by all the pain that she got to experience. I was like, oh, all her friends died? Good.
Exactly.
Like, oh, I got to stab her lover? Awesome.
Yes. So
being able to experience and see that pain that I wanted to inflict on her made me feel good.
Gotcha. Yeah. So but that's what I love about this game is there's so many different takeaways for it. I don't feel like you can tell someone, like, here's how you have to feel about every little thing. And I think it's cool that you can, like, still love the game even though you don't like it. Like, I actually really I love that additional layer of how you can experience this game.
True. Go ahead. Like, because I know Greg wanted to hear what you had to say about that.
About what in particular?
In terms of the
where do I begin?
Situation of the make a break loving her, and like, what was it about Abby?
Okay, so Abby is a character whose story are
almost balanced.
Yeah, she got them arms
getting correctly. Yeah.
Now here's the thing: like, they knew that introducing this character and what she did, people would not like her. There's a way to tell her story to make everybody empathize with her. The order that they told her story in was fucked. If they told her story in a different order, if they started the game where you're playing as young Abby and you get to experience these things, it would naturally bring people on board with her. But by the time you start playing as Abby, you already hate her. So majority of us, we're not going to get won over because we already can't stand her. And she's just walking through like a Terminator, one-shotting people, and like, there's no weight to anybody that dies, really. Like, and my thing about part one is everyone that died in part one, there was a weight to it. You felt it. Like, every single death was emotional. In part two, people just die and they move on so fast. Like, you don't have time to process. You're like, all right, one to another one, on to another, on to another one. She's just doing all this stuff. And then they try to spin the story and try to make you care for it. But by that time, I'm like, I don't care. And like, and I said it even during my stream while I was playing as her. I said, I don't like playing as her, but if they find a way to make me like her or if there's a payoff, then okay, I'm okay with it. I never got that payoff. So we're going through all of this stuff. I'm supposed to care about everything that she's doing. And there was that big disconnect where like they never won me over. Like I don't care. I don't care. And they never made me care.
Do you feel like you were being forced to care about Abby?
Yes. Because like there's so many parallels from what Ellie goes through and what Abby goes through. Like even like almost everyone that Ellie encounters and kills, you experience a different side with Abby. Like even the girl with the Vita that you stab in the neck, Abby's talking to her and chatting her up and all kinds. So they try to pit one against the other and like Ellie's bad, but Ellie's good, but Abby's good. Like feel bad for Abby because she went through this and this. I'm like, I don't care. And it's like the point where they have you play as Abby, it's like it's such that like they force this to you and they make you play as a person that you don't like. I've never had an experience with a video game where I did not have a good time. Like up until that point, it was great. I loved it. Like I had a great time. I was having such a bad time. I turned my camera off. Like I'm like because when you're not having a good time, people see that. And I'm like, I don't want people to see me not having a good time, even though I'm complaining. I'm making a jump off bridges. And like, if I were to do a death compilation of every time I killed Abby, it'd probably be an hour long video. It's ridiculous. I made her die in every single occurrence, like every cliff I jumped off, every enemy I died to on purpose. I'm like, all right, can the game end now? Can I go back to Ellie? Like I was being forced to play a character that I did not like, could not relate to, could not empathize with for 13 hours. My last of a stream was 18 hours. I did 3 streams where I beat the game. My last one was 18 hours, and 13 of which I was playing as Abby. 13 hours, I did not have a good time.
So I couldn't stand it. So the experiment essentially failed with you because yes. I think it did work for, I would say, the majority of people. It did work. Like me playing as Abby, I did not enjoy playing as Abby, and I was actually very surprised when I was talking to D-Pity about it while we were both playing the stream, we were both streaming right around the same time. And I would just pop in and check. And I'm like, oh my God, you're at this level with Abby. He's like, dude, I love playing as Abby. She's a beast. I love all this. And I'm like, but for me, it was just playing her. I had the benefit of people giving me a forewarning of like, because for me, it was a thing of like, look, yo, they're already at the climax of the story right now. I'm coming in as Ellie. Abby's got the gun to Tommy's head. And I'm like, yo, let's go. And then suddenly, flashback. And then I get my fans just basically tell me, yeah, about this, you got to get ready because you're going to have to go through every single day. And I hated almost every moment of that. I understood what they were trying to do. And if I go back and I play those levels now, I think I would enjoy them a lot more. But it is that experiment of walking in Abby's shoes to understand what it's like to be the person that took away your favorite character. Not for me. I didn't give a shit about Joel, honestly speaking. I thought he had it coming, and I was on board with that. When he died, I'm like, this is awesome. Let's see where the story goes. But I understand for other people growing up with The Last of Us, how that could affect them. That's like if somebody killed Batman for me, I guess. I don't know if I could do it, walk in like, Batman's killer
shoes. Someone made a good comparison about that, and after I finished the game, and somebody in my chat would say, like, that's like if they made a Batman game where someone killed Batman's parents, and then you played as the killer and find out his inspiration, what he was doing that day, and his motivations and all that. I'm like, that's kind of what it's like. That's exactly what it's like.
Okay, let's bring that up real quick because I do want to talk about that because I thought that was one of the best points. By the way, saying Drew's new diss track is going to be
13 hours.
Appreciate that. Thank you for the super chat. I want to talk about that because I actually thought that was the most creative part of the game, which was Abby's father's reveal. They flashback. So again, for me, my background on The Last of Us was I only just got into The Last of Us a few months ago. I beat it only 3 months ago. So all of that was fresh in my head. And I walked away from the first game wondering, I had a weird feeling about the end of that game. I'm like, wait, what? Am I the villain? When I went around killing all the Fireflies in the first game, when it took that dark turn, I was like, wait a second, am I still a good guy anymore? I thought I was doing something right. Wait, I just murdered a fucking doctor, the nurse, when I went Punisher mode on everybody for this girl, but it left a huge discussion in my head. I'm like, did Joel make the right choice? And I had to Google that shit and be like, wait, do we find out later like that Ellie, there's more people like Ellie or whatever? So that was actually a big point in my head from the first game. And I'm glad that they Naughty Dog picked up on that for the second game. So for me, jumping into Abby again, going into her flashback, and then when seeing that her father, I'm like, God damn, this dude looks so familiar. And I was like, I think I saw this dude on Brooklyn Nine-Nine or something. And I couldn't put it in my head. I couldn't put it in my head. Where did I see this dude before? And then they do the big reveal that not only is he a doctor, he's the doctor, the one with the possible cure. I loved every moment of that because it had me second guessing everything. And I'm like, wait a second. Yo, Abby is not just a murderer. She's essentially, she went on some Batman goddamn path. You killed my motherfucking father. I'm going to work out. I'm going to do CrossFit. I'm going to bench press my ass. And I'm going to hunt you down for 3 years. I love that. I didn't necessarily love Abby, but I love that motivation. And for me, that sold me a lot. And on the fact that even after getting her revenge, even after getting that, she couldn't sleep, similar to Ellie. She couldn't sleep. She couldn't eat. Everybody in her whole crew was struggling, no pun intended, but struggling with what they did and how they, you know, they were supposed to be Firefly saving the world, but they just legit golf clubs this man to death. Right. And shit, and none of them got out unscathed. And I love that sort of, not necessarily a redemption arc of Abby, but this recompense and a penance that she was doing in essentially becoming the new Joel. So I love that particular storytelling. I'm sorry that you couldn't enjoy it and you didn't like it, but I thought that was some great masterful storytelling, because at that point that I talked about with the movie theater, I was like, no, I want to kill Abby. I'm ready to do this. But when we get back to that movie theater again and they switch sides, I'm looking at Ellie a little bit differently. I'm looking at Abby a little bit differently. And I'm like, wait, I don't necessarily want to kill Ellie so much that toward the final fight, when we're switching as, I believe we're playing as Ellie, I don't want to kill Abby anymore. And I thought that was beautiful the way they played with our emotions like that.
Well, so, I think what you're, like everything you're talking about, I know we got like a whole bunch of different varying opinions here. Yeah. I think what you're talking about is, that's what I love about this game, is it deals so, like with the effect that you had. You play The Last of Us 1 through Joel's perspective.
Yes.
And then when you're playing through Joel's perspective, it's like there is a bit of a conflicting feeling of, well, damn, we don't have a cure now. But you also really love Ellie because you're looking at it from Joel's perspective.
Yes.
So this game really deals with consequences. And one thing that I really find fascinating, especially about revenge stories, generally speaking, is that usually a character's arc is... like, look at John Wick or any revenge story, pretty much is something wrong happens to them. They get revenge. And what's the completion of their arc? They get revenge. And I've always been fascinated to see what would it be like if a character, what does the person become post revenge? What does that do to them? And it's not like Abby gets her revenge and then suddenly it's all happy go lucky for this girl. Right. And everything is just consequences after consequences, and everything in this game is motivation. So like a lot of it is, it's like good intended motivation from us, from like a self-imposed point of view. It's like everyone has their intentions, yet it can be selfish motivation that can lead to devastating consequences and often lingering repercussions on an emotional level and how it can affect everyone else around you. Because like when I first started playing as Abby, I fucking hated it. I didn't like that. It took me a while, like a long way. From a gameplay point of view, I was just annoyed of, man, I gotta like upgrade all my shit again. Like, this is gonna take forever. I don't want to do this. And it took me a while. First, it was like, okay, I'm warming up to her. And then it took me a while to like really get where she's coming from. And to Drew's perspective, I have a question for you. let's say the game did start off where you're actually playing from Abby's perspective for the first half, and then they paint Ellie in this villainous light through most of the game. I don't think you could just flip it though, to be honest, because Abby is not even aware of Ellie through her whole like solo journey. Like, that's why I don't think you can flip it from a structural point of view, because it's like her friends are being killed off and people from the WLF are being killed off, but she's not even aware of all that shit going on because she's just doing her own little journey. And then she checks back in. She's like, what the hell? People are dying. My Owen's dead. What's going on?
Yep.
So I don't think structurally that would work. So I'm curious to know though, because I actually get what you're talking about. But I feel like that's kind of the point of the game. Exactly. At the same time.
Right.
Because when I look at it from Abby's perspective, you know, she doesn't see herself as the bad guy. Normally any villain doesn't see themselves as the bad guy, but she's like, her father was killed by some mysterious guy named Joel who she doesn't fucking know.
Right.
And she just wants her revenge. So what if they did flip the structure around and you did play as Abby and you're playing as her for the first half and Ellie's painted as the villain? I mean, would you be able to receive what the game is trying to get you to feel if suddenly the game's trying to tell you Ellie's a bad guy?
And more importantly, before that as well, I do really want to know, do you think Abby was wrong for killing Joel? Because Joel killed her father.
All right, first of all, my issue with the game isn't with Joel dying, because we knew that was going to happen. It was inevitable. So my issue is not with Joel dying at all. But if they were to reorder the events and not necessarily paint Ellie as the bad guy, just tell it in a different order. Like, because I feel like the order that they presented the game in is a clusterfuck. And the way they bring you into playing Abby, right then and there, half of the people playing the game are not going to be on board with it. But okay, if it was told in a different order, like I said, a genius way of doing it would be if they started when Abby was younger, and then you could go all over the place if you want to. But by the time she kills Joel, if you're already empathetic towards her, and then that happens, then you're kind of conflicted with what you're feeling. You like her, you hate her at the same time. Mm-hmm. That would be a better way to do it than having her kill him at the beginning of the game, and then halfway through the game, then you place her from the beginning. That didn't make sense to me. Like, by that time, instead of bringing you into her and you already hating her, a better way would be if by the time she kills Joel, you already feel bad for the things she's gone through and how much she suffered, and then you're coming into it and you know it's a necessary evil and you both like it and you hate it at the same time. That would have been better to me.
One thing I wanted to interject real quick, though, is let's go with the current timeline of this universe, is the fact that this game story gets leaked. So based upon your particular idea, you're already going to know if you're playing as Abby, you're going to end up killing Joel. So wouldn't that be kind of a waste of a game anyways?
I mean, but that's just going off based on if people read the leaks. And if things get leaked, then people are going to know things anyway. So, I mean, it's okay. about telling a concise story and structurally sound so that by the time the event happens that you know people are not going to like, you accept it better than shock factor. Because when it happens, it's like, no, go ahead.
Well, I wanted to ask both you and Mai as well. Do you both, even while playing as Abby and the fact that they're putting you in the perspective of showing, like, at least the way the game was communicating to me personally, was that Abby is not really a bad guy. It's just through Ellie's perspective, she's a bad guy. but she's not really a bad guy. That's at least what the game was trying to tell me. But as you guys were still playing as her, even while hating her and whatever, did you still feel that she is the bad guy and is the villain? Regardless of how you like the character or not, do you still feel she's the bad guy?
I think she's a terrible person, but, you know, she does things because they live in a shitty world and, you know, shit happens.
Okay.
Yeah, no. I mean, I totally agree, because with the world in the state that it is, there is no thing as good guys and bad guys. It's all about going for yourself and only caring about yourself. Mm-hmm. So in the case of Ellie, in the case of Abby, they're each just gunning for their own, like, what they want for themselves, right? So I don't know, I just can't get over the fact that, I mean, I hated Abby in the end, but I understand her motivation, I understand Ellie's motivation, and I think, I mean, seeing both at the end of the day, it's not really saying like, oh, Abby was bad. I can't believe I'm playing her. Oh, and then, oh, now Ellie's the bad guy and I have to go kill her. It's just, everyone's just out for themselves. So
my question is then to you, just like I'm genuinely asking, I'm not trying to like fight you or anything, is that what is it that you don't, why don't you like Abby? And that could go to all three of you, actually. Like, why don't you like Abby, the person? You just don't like the character, the personality? Like, what is it about her you don't like?
I don't like her for what she did to Joel. Because in the first game, I became so attached to him. Even in the first game, when I thought that he had died the first time, when he got that here, mm-hmm. I cried. Yeah. So then when I saw him beating her, it was like someone beating your friend. Yeah, and whether or not I'm in the wrong or they're in the right or whatever, it doesn't matter. If you hurt someone I like or that I care about, I'll kill you.
Exactly. So
it does, like, so that's the only reason why I hated Abby, is because of what she did.
I see.
Okay.
And so you couldn't understand why she did. Like,
I mean, I understand why she.
You couldn't feel bad for her after finding out who Joel killed?
No, because I put myself as if I am in the game, right? Because I, when it comes to any sort of story-driven game, it's very immersive, and I think about what I might do in that position. So for me, because I was so attached to Ellie, I was so attached to Joel, like, it doesn't matter her story or whatever. Like, I understand, I see her motivation and what she did, her character development throughout the game, but that doesn't change the fact that I hate her for what she did.
Mm-hmm. So what was, I can respect that.
Yeah.
I as well, but what was your reaction to the end of the first game? Because I'm starting to see a difference of some of that.
In the first game, I think that what Joel did wasn't, I mean, if you think about it, you're like, okay, that's a pretty shitty thing that he did. Obviously, instead of letting Ellie die and then possibly making a vaccine, we don't even know if the vaccine was even possible.
Exactly.
So if you were Joel, she's like your daughter. So Who do I care about? I care about me. I'm Joel, right? So I care about whatever makes me happy. And obviously I love her. I care about her like my daughter. So of course I'm going to save her. If it was me and it was like my dog or someone, my mom or someone, I would have done the same exact thing.
Like my thing with the end of the first game is the way the doctors went about it is you didn't even give Ellie a chance to even agree to the shit. So when Joel goes in there and he says, stop operating on her, what Abby's father does is just doesn't back off. He grabs the scalpel and says, I'm not going to let you take her. So he could have defused the situation better. Like, he could handle it better. Now, Joel lost his daughter. And you get to see a whole character growth with him from loss to acceptance to getting a new daughter. He's not going to let that go for just a chance that maybe this vaccine will work. They didn't even know. It's not 100% certain that it's even going to work. So he comes in there. The doctor's not going to let him take it. So what is he going to do? Of course, in my shoes, I'm going to kill everybody in there because I'm not going to let you do this. So the way I looked at it is Joel did what any of us would do in that situation. Like, absolutely. So and my, like, it's not about whether it's right or wrong, whether he's good or bad. He's human. And he did what all of us are going to do. That's how I look at it anyway. And like from that to the second game, the way I look at it is, if you have such an emotional attachment like I do to the first game, when you come into the second game and you see what's going on, you're not going to like it. You're already not going to like it. And then when he killed Joel, it's like, all right, now I want to kill Abby. And when you don't even get the chance to kill Abby, you're like, all right, well, I just spent 13 hours playing Abby and I don't even get any payoff. So it's like, what did I even do this for?
Okay. I guess that's the next big talk. Greg, you want to say something?
But isn't the... I thought that was kind of the point was that I felt like the ending, because honestly, when I first played it, Last of Us 2, when you do get to the point where she's about to kill Abby, I'm having the same conflicting feelings Akasan was having of like, I don't really want Abby to die, but I also get if Ellie does it. But then when she didn't do it, I was immediately followed with, why the fuck didn't you kill Abby? What the hell? instantly having that feeling. But then when you see the flashback, I was like, okay, I get it. Like, what they're talking about is this whole theme of like this cyclical nature of revenge really is like what we're talking about is learning to be understanding and forgiveness. And maybe the plot doesn't, if you're not liking the plot of how it's unfolding and like maybe the themes are not working for you, right? And I can understand that. But I felt like it was about, really, this was about forgiveness and just kind of a beautiful thing to that.
Go ahead.
Yeah. No, you can go.
And particularly the ending with the game, the thing that I thought was kind of interesting, particularly hearing Drew's point and a lot of people that were mad that you couldn't kill Abby. I feel like, and I'm not trying to be mean, but I feel like you actually failed understanding the game if that's all you walked away from wanting to kill Abby. The whole point was to understand that Ellie bring it, just like Abby killing Joel didn't bring her peace. Mm. Ellie killing Abby yeah. would not do the same.
Yeah.
And what that flashback at the end, what the reason that I teared the fuck up
so did
at
I,
the
yeah. end yeah.
with
yeah.
that last flashback, because to me, that proved a lot of things to me. It didn't prove Abby, I mean, Ellie was not mad at Abby, but Abby was a fucking beacon for Ellie to focus all her anger, her frustration. Ellie, the biggest enemy for Ellie was Ellie herself, and the fact that she didn't have time to repair her relationship between Joel. And earlier, Drew mentioned that they didn't even give Ellie a choice. The doctors didn't even give Ellie a choice, where I understand where he's coming from, but we find out that she would have done it regardless. Mm. She wanted her life to matter, and that's one of the main reasons she was mad at Joel, because she would have stepped on that chance from the beginning, like, yo, yeah. take my fucking brain. And on top of that, hashtag Tess died for nothing in the first game. The fact that Joel did what he did. But I thought.
But I think I feel like Joel. Sorry to interrupt. I do feel like though that Joel doesn't feel right about what he did. At the beginning of the game, the way they set it up is like, hey, we're gonna have a gray fucking area for you to explore in this game. Of the fight, like he, like when I first played The Last of Us, I was like, ooh, man, he just lied to Ellie. But I was also like, I'm so glad Ellie's alive. That was like my main predominant feeling. Of I'm glad Ellie's alive and I'm glad Joel did that. But then when this game, Last of Us 2, starts, it does present the argument of, was that really the right choice? And look how Joel is even haunted by this decision. And this whole talk about forgiveness and the cyclical nature of revenge, that's kind of going back to the thing I was bringing up earlier with revenge movies, generally speaking, is the character's closure in movies often is they get the final kill.
Yeah,
and I love that this game is presenting that won't bring you closure. And as much as an audience member, that's the funny thing though, like what Drew's talking about, or even what Mai was talking about earlier, is that, you know, like you want to kill Abby, and as an audience member, that might bring you closure. But let's look at Ellie. Would that bring Ellie closure? You know, like that. And I love that debate basically about it.
And I think that's the biggest problem, is the fact that I think a lot of people also don't realize that Ellie realized exactly why Abby, she couldn't kill Abby. And Ellie realized who Abby's father was, and what Joel did was a bad thing. And there's a particular part in the story where she is torturing Nora, I believe. It's Nora in the hospital. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the first times Ellie becomes like Joel, essentially, and she's shaking and she's just like, fuck, I got her to talk, but now she knows everything. And you start noticing that Ellie starts changing a lot after that, and she's not even sure about everything she needs to do. All she knows is the fact that she can't sleep, she can't eat, she's trying to have this life on the farm and everything. And so she thinks that maybe revenge is the only thing for her. And it's at that moment in time when revenge is on the tip of her tongue, when she's about to close the deal, choking out Abby, she gets that flashback of Joel, and she realizes that Abby is not the enemy. So for me, I thought that was beautiful. I'm sorry that other people couldn't get on board with that.
I have a question for Mai.
Hmm.
If you don't like Abby, what was it about the game that you actually enjoyed though? When playing as Abby, like
that, I don't like Abby as a person, but I like the way that they told her story. Like I think, contrary to what Drew was saying, like I actually like the progression of everything, because for me, when it came to The Last of Us 2, I avidly avoided spoilers. I didn't stream the game on purpose because I didn't want people to come into my stream and say, hey, this is going to happen. So that's why I locked myself away and just played it by myself. So I came to it knowing absolutely nothing. Which was, I thought, how people really should have experienced it, right? I think the fact that it got spoiled is what ruined it for everyone, right?
I mean, there's a lot of channels who are doing great numbers on their views right now who can talk about why this game is a piece of shit without even playing the video game.
Yeah, are you talking about people with their hormones are lined up correctly, Greg? Is that the kind of people you're referring to?
Yeah.
Are you talking about Tyrone? Yeah. I thought that shit was so funny.
Yeah.
But... shout out to our brother from the React app. Tyrone doing big numbers on a game he hasn't played.
But yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, I think her character was good. I liked the story. I thought the story was good. I liked the way that it ended. I almost kind of wish that it gave you two options that, hey, if you wanted to kill her, you could. If you did, if you didn't want, you could
skip. That'd be neat. Yeah.
I think that would have been fantastic. The only thing that I thought was kind of weird when I was playing the game was that, you know, Joel was a pretty smart guy. The only thing that I thought was really weird when I started playing it was I was like, why did he tell her his real name?
I keep saying that.
That's the only thing that really bothered me. I'm like,
wait. I'm sorry. What's the? I'm confused.
So she's what she's saying is how come, because a lot of people have pointed this out, and I don't understand it, but people are saying that who's echoing here?
You.
No. So people are saying that Joel was so stupid in this particular game. He gave his name to Abby.
He didn't know who they were.
No. But that's not even there's two arguments I can make for that. One, Tommy grabs Abby and Wilder, Joel is holding the door and he's like, look, calm down. Look, I'm Tommy. That's Joel. We're going to get you out of here. Then later, they go to the safe. And after that, Abby's like, oh, shit. Well, you know, I know a place. And they take him to the wolves' territory or whatever. And Tommy introduces himself again. Joel hesitates, and he's just like, "Well, you know," he said, "all right, again, I'm Joel," like that. Second point, the second thing I'm also talking about is the fact that if you actually, when you play the game and you read, if you actually read the notes that you're picking up all throughout the game, you'll see that. The Jacksonville or Jackson, when they're making rounds, they're recruiting people. They need people, and they're going and trying to get people to build a community. So it's been about 3 years. There, you know, it's safe to say that they have kind of been a little more lenient, a little more flexible with giving out their names and shit. So
they got soft.
Yeah. Exactly.
My main thing is like, all right, so the game starts with Joel telling Tommy what happened, and then Tommy knows, so they know people are coming after him. So that's I don't get that.
But do they know? Or is that all the fireflies were taken care of?
Right, they've assumed that most of they killed all fireflies.
And the fireflies are all dead, aren't they? Isn't that like
no, the theory? No, the fireflies became the WLF.
Well, some of them went there.
A lot of them went to Catalina. Mm. Yeah.
No, it's kind of a fair point all around here. I didn't actually consider that part of like, yeah, that's right. I don't know. Maybe it's because it's been a few years, right? What's the year gap?
Four years.
Okay.
So, I mean, and you see Tommy actually talk to Joel in the beginning of the game, and he's just like, look, that's a hell of a shit. I don't know if I would have done anything differently, but you start to see that they're still trying to build for a community and try, you know, they can't safeguard that shit forever. And whatever. So
well, I think the circumstances of the presentation of the situation also factor into to that. Like they rescued Abby. It doesn't look like it's a situation where I think this Abby person's trying to hunt someone down. Like it doesn't present itself that way. And then they bring them in, and it feels like a really welcoming environment when Joel and Tommy are brought into the that whatever mansion it was that they were being held at. So however, though, I mean, it might have helped to Drew's point. It could have helped the plot, I suppose, a little bit if there was a natural part to put it in of, you know, Joel at least being aware that there's a possible there's a target on his head, you know.
Like I got a lot of issues with the game, but that I don't really like. That's a minor gripe. I'm like, okay, they had to push the story along, so you know, things happen.
My main
issue with because I get what they're trying to do with the story and the themes they're trying to play with. No, I understand all of that. My main thing is when you go into this IP with established characters that we love and you try to pull this now, a lot of us are not going to buy it. If it was a completely new IP with new characters, you could tell the same exact story, it'd be great. But you're using characters that we already love and have an attachment to, and now you're trying to do this, you're trying to do introduce new things and spin things around. It's like, yes, we're not going to, a majority of us not going
to
go for it.
What would you have done then? That's what I would like to know, because that's the one thing I don't hear so much is like, okay, you hate the story, but what would have been The Last of Us 2 have been for you?
I would have told it in a different order.
So you mean like the same plot but different structure.
If they wanted to tell the same exact story, they could have told the same exact story in a different order. My main thing is when you don't empathize with Abby, which is one of the biggest characters in this game, it falls apart. And if you never get on board with Abby, there's half of the game that you don't like, and nothing will bring you around to that.
But isn't that's subjective to the individual player though, isn't it?
It is, but like a majority of us don't like Abby.
And I would say a majority, though. I don't know about that. I think the loudest majority, like Greg often says, there's always going to be a loud minority on the internet. But I wouldn't say as far as the majority of people think the story is bad that have actually played it.
In my experience, then, of like 90% of the people that I have been around and talked to can't stand it. They cannot stand it. They pick it apart. There's like thousands of YouTube videos now just picking the story apart, like from beginning to end, the plot holes and all that. And, you know, that's further than I'll go, but a majority of people do not like this story at all.
I mean, yeah, I think when Akasan was first asking us at the top of like the people in our circles. And that's my point is like you often are friends or whatever will attract those who are most likely going to share a similar. It's rare where I hate something and I'm like, fuck, all my friends like it. And I like it's a rare situation for me.
Maybe Ghostbusters.
Yeah.
And like even with me, like one of the biggest complaints I got on YouTube is these guys like everything. I can't trust their opinion. There's nothing you don't like. So, you know, there's a lot of things I do like. It's very rare for me to come across something that I don't like. And for me to not like this, then I got to know, all right, there's something going on here where I just. And the only thing I have an issue with is the story, because I love the gameplay. I love the mechanics. I love, like, everything. The graphically is beautiful. Like, this game, the guitar alone is I've never played guitar like that a day in my life. And I could spend 2 hours on guitar in this game. Yeah, it's fucking phenomenal. Like, and they've done things in this game that no other game has ever done. And that's the first game has done that, too. It's an amazing game. It's just when the story falls apart, because this is a story-driven game. When the story doesn't work for you, the whole game falls apart for you.
Yeah, now, I can respect that. Yeah.
This game isn't a 10 out of 10, but it's also not a 0 out of 10 because it does a lot of things right. Whether you love it or hate it, even I can appreciate the fact that it's still an amazing game. Like, it is. Like, the combat, even when I was playing with Abby, because, like, her mechanics are different than Ellie's mechanics, the way she carries herself and fights and all that is completely different. And I loved it. I loved it. I upgraded damn near every weapon. I found everything. People were complaining that I was looting too much. I'm like, well, go fuck yourself. I'm taking my time with this game. I love it. And it's like, I love what the game did, except for the story. The story is the only thing that up until the Abby part, because from the beginning to when they made me take control of Abby, I loved it.
I'm sorry.
Well, I just want to say something I do want to keep in mind here. Mai, you said it took you how long? 10 hours to play the game?
60.
60.
60 hours. How long in how many days did it take?
Well, I do work a day job, so it would just be me grinding it after work. So that's why it took me 2 weeks to finish it.
2 to 3 hours a day? Mm-hmm. A night or so? Yeah. Okay, Greg?
I mean, yeah, I would only be able to play in the evening, so it took me about 30 hours in total to beat the game.
Right, but it took you how many days in terms of the cycle?
I think just seven straight days.
Okay, so about a week or so. It took me about a week and a half doing streams, and I was streaming, so it takes a little bit longer.
Yeah,
something I do want to point out here, Drew. I love you, but you binged this entire game.
I binge everything.
Yeah, I know you do, but I think that's also a big problem is I respect your hustle, but at the same time, I think you are in that camp that binged that game so hard just to be able to beat it that you were tired. You know, you couldn't really feel that thing because you couldn't do it in doses. Personally, and you know, you can tell me I'm wrong about that. That's fine. But for me, when I was playing as Abby and I knew I had to fucking play three more days, I told my stream, I was like, you know what? We've been streaming for 5 hours. I'm going to stop right here and I'm going to come back to this later with a fresh mind again. And for me, that helped me with Abby's story because I could come back in, but I don't think this was a game that was meant to be binged like a Netflix show. Some shows are not meant to be binged because you're supposed to take a time and absorb it.
Now, one thing is like I had no indication of how long I'd be playing because I avoided everything. I didn't even look at chat while I was streaming. Like, right. So I had my moderators in there. I turned chat off completely. So I had no indicator of I'll be playing as Abby, how long I'll be playing as Abby. So everything was completely blind. Now, with me, I operate a little differently than normal people. Like, I did a 73-hour stream in Nier Automata, and I still love that game. It's my favorite game of all time. So, like, the amount of time I play a game isn't going to change anything with me. I'm not human. Like, I process things differently, and I can push myself past, like, normal humanity. Like, I don't operate like that. I don't operate like that. I stayed for 5 days. I played Nier Automata for 73 hours. Like, and that's my favorite game of all time. So the amount of time I play a game in one sitting isn't going to change anything. If I love the game, I love the game. That it wouldn't change that for me.
Well, I mean, to find out, I mean, did what Akasan's talking about of him saying how that if Drew applied a little bit of intervals or breaks, did that help in your reciprocating experience with The Last of Us 2 by taking breaks to like maybe reflect or think about it or let things digest?
I honestly think it did because the reason why my gameplay was probably so long is because there's a lot of times where I would actually just pause the game. I would maybe just do one fight sequence and be like, I need to decompress. And then I would just pause it and go maybe watch YouTube or go eat a snack. So, I mean, I think
I remember talking with Mai when it happened. Because she posted, I remember you posted on Instagram after Joel died. You're like, oh, fuck. And I privately messaged you and you're like, yeah, I'm going to have to come back to this.
I cried for 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Wow.
I gave myself time to mourn a fictional character.
That's what I did after part one. Like after Sarah died in the beginning, that's the first game. And I'll remember this for the rest of my life. I turned the game off and I went outside because I'm like, I got to do something else because it hit me that hard. I had to turn the game off and walk away from it. Like it.
Yeah. But Joel dying doesn't do that for you.
No, because all it did was
Sarah character in the first 5 minutes of a game.
It was more shock factor than anything else. Like when Sarah died versus when Joel died, it's like shock factor in a different way.
That's a fair
point. It's like he gets tortured and he dies. And it's like, all it does is piss you off and wants you to get revenge. So that's a catalyst for Ellie's journey for revenge. So she's mad, you're mad. Oh, all right, let's go get this motherfucker.
But
then you don't get her.
That's what I love about the game. I gotta admit that is that it sets you up for a typical revenge story.
It does.
It sets you up for, all right, you're gonna have the cathartic experience of going on this revenge story. It's gonna go A to Z. She'll get her revenge, right? Like that's what it sets you up for. And then with Abby's story, it goes, all right, now let's deconstruct what it might really be like for an individual if they were to go on a revenge spree and what that would do to
them. And by the time you come back to present day, it's like Naughty Dog is just like, boom, now how do you feel, motherfucker?
Because,
I felt the same.
When you got Ellie, she's about, like, she has her at the theater, and then Abby shows up after killing, what's that fucking guy's name?
Glenn. Glenn.
Jesse. After killing Jesse, and then it goes, all right, she's at the moment where she could get a revenge, Ellie. Yes. Now let's go back to the character who got her revenge, and let's see what's happened to her. You know. So I mean,
roller coaster. Yeah,
I really can't. I honestly can't blame anyone for not liking Abby, and I can't blame Drew for not liking the game. Like, I just can't. Mm. It's just one of those games, you know.
Yeah, like, go ahead.
Someone in the chat said Last Jedi. Like, it's the Last Jedi of the games, and
I agree
with that. I'm like, there's some people who just fucking hate the Last Jedi. Some people are like, it's the most brilliant Star Wars movie. You know, it's just one of those games, and you can't fault someone on that.
Even me, like, I don't blame people for liking it. Because if you don't have that attachment to the first game, like one thing I found out is people that that knew about the leaks or didn't really care about the characters in the first one, they play the game like, okay, yes, it's great, you know. But if you have that emotional attachment to these characters, 9 times out of 10, you go into part two and you don't like the way it was done, just from a story standpoint.
Right.
And that's something that is kind of hard to shake. When you have this attachment to these characters, and this is what happens to them, obviously you're gonna get pissed off and you're not really gonna be on board with it. But people that like the game, I get it too. I understand. That's why I'll never say, no, you're wrong if you like it. Here's why. I get it. I get why people like it. I get why people don't like it.
You see, like, I think you have a great point, though, because, like, when you and Mai were talking about Joel's decision to kill the Fireflies at the end of The Last of Us 1, you both were like, yeah, he should. I mean, they don't even know if the cure's there, right? I get that. And to be fair, there's a lot of people who I know that love this game, like in the circles of friends, whatever. Mm-hmm. There's people who were like, yeah, I love Joel, but I didn't view him as a hero at all after the end of The Last of Us 1.
Yeah.
And if I noticed that the people who don't view Joel as a hero, they're able to get on board with this game even more. Yeah. Because I was kind of in that camp. Like, I love Joel. Like, he's fucking awesome. I love him.
Yeah.
At the same time, when this game started, I was also like, you know what? It might be a little fucked up with Joel. Like, it had me questioning that, you know?
I agree. Okay, elephant in the room here. I would like to know if Abby, as we all know, Abby and the voice actress for Abby has been getting a lot of hate. There's a lot of people that have been, shitting on Abby the entire playthrough. I definitely know Drew was not about that, so I'm definitely making sure people know that. Drew disliked the game, but he did not dislike Abby's appearance and things like that. Mm. But there have been people that were shitting on Abby since the beginning of the story, since she was introduced, talking about her body, talking about how she might be a trans character. I have a question. If Abby instead was Abel, a man named Abel, and they did some Cain and Abel type bullshit, type of biblical type proportions and killed Joe. If Abby was a man, would there be as much controversy? Would there be as much hate, honestly speaking?
I think if Abby was a man, people find other things to complain about. So, I mean, that wouldn't change anything. People would still complain about something. They would find something to latch on to and complain.
Yeah, I don't think it would solve the problem. However, I think the impact would definitely be lessened. I can meet you in the halfway point here. It's like, look at Negan in The Walking Dead. He's exactly. like a main character now. He's right. like a main character now. And he's a protagonist, essentially.
He had a bat.
And he like, he did something pretty similar to what Abby did in this game.
Exactly.
And I feel like normally with the bravado of that, how men are portrayed in games and movies and shows, that there's this whole thing. Like, I mean, I'm a guy, so I feel like I shouldn't be the spokesperson for this necessarily. However, I do think that the way women are portrayed a lot of the time, it's easy to suddenly bring in a fucking sexist agenda all of a sudden. And I noticed that did happen with Abby, like, especially in the body type image. Like I'm not going to sit here and be like, what are you guys talking about? Abby's fucking hot. Like, I didn't think that.
Yeah.
At the same time, I wasn't like, this is fucking disturbing and gross and distracting. I wasn't in that camp either.
Right.
I do think that people would certainly have issues and certainly have gripes, even if it was a guy. I just think the impact and maybe getting on board to play as a him might have been a little bit easier for people to adjust to, generally speaking, you know, like, I think because some people will try to say that it's like, it's only men who fucking hate Abby. And that's not the case. I mean, fucking Mai's right here. Mai just said she doesn't like Abby, you know? So it's not the case that it's a strictly men being sexist. That's not the situation. However, I think because of like programming or whatever, that we will be like, you know, that's a Hobbs and Shaw movie. It's not the same thing, but let's face it. Shaw was a terrible guy. And, you know, and now we got a movie where like, he's a good guy. I think he's a hero now, you know? I mean, but even fucking like in Game of Thrones before we got to that final season, everyone was like, you know, that Jaime Lannister is having a great arc, isn't he? He's a good guy now. So I just think there's a lot of examples that can go to serve that when it's a guy in a villainous role, we can often be a little bit more open to, there's a chance they could change or they can be a good person or something. I can't say that it's 100% that would be the case, obviously, because this is a hypothetical. But I believe it. I'm likely to believe that, you know.
I'm just kind of curious, as a woman, did you feel that it was harder to accept Abby, particularly because of that? Because, you know, I'm just talking about from a woman's perspective, Loki, that just comes to mind. Loki has kind of been seen, he was the villain, but he started getting turned into this like sex object, and women love to love Loki like that. If Tom Hiddleston played Abby or Abel in this game, would it have changed your perspective on things?
No.
Damn.
Because I hate, it doesn't matter if you're a guy or girl, cis or trans, it doesn't matter. If I don't like what you did, I hate you.
Thank you.
I just think that I know a lot of people are saying, this game is just trying to be too woke, right? I think they do need to be sensitive to the fact that there's still a lot of people that have opinions that are like that, right? So I feel like they should have known that some of that flack would have come, right?
Yeah.
Do you guys feel that this game was too woke?
I mean, they just tried to add a lot of elements that are very controversial, right? Like having a very butch female I believe she was cis since she was into that guy, and then having, you know, a trans character. These are things that are just, you know, yes, they're accepted now in 2020, but there's still a lot of people that may not agree with that, right? So
But I mean, at the same time, we had a fucking cult running around and fucking monks doing some weird ass shit. Then we had slave trade toward the end of the game. Yeah. So I never like when I keep on hearing people saying that this shit is woke and whatever, and it's trying to be in your face, I never felt like the game was ever like that. Yes, Ellie likes women, but she's been liking women since the beginning, since the DLC came out with Left Behind. So I never felt like that was a big deal. Or like they were trying to be in your face about it. Lev was like, I didn't even realize Lev was born a girl till way later in the game, and was like, I just shaved my head. I'm like, oh shit, okay, he was born a woman. Whatever. Still looks like Aang from the Avatar to me. So whatever.
Yeah, it took me a while to pick up on that too. I thought it was like a Shanghai Noon situation.
Yes.
Like, he cut his hair, and that's why they're mad at him. Like that's what I thought it was.
I never thought there was some agenda being pushed into your face here.
Well, I mean, I don't think it is. Like, we're all essentially people of color here in this live stream, actually. But, you know, and now fuck this chat. All right, I just realized what this is. This is a woke live stream. I don't want to do that. I think that, you know, a lot of times when we don't really notice, it's a bunch of white. Now people call it out, right? Like it's a bunch of white people. Like there's no diversity here. At the same time, on the flip side, you can tell when it's pandering diversity. Mm-hmm. And in this case, I don't feel like it was, because with Lev, that played into the storyline. But for the most part, the other characters, it's not really a hugely discussed thing or something that they're really pushing in your face. Like there's a little nugget of a moment with Ellie being gay that happens at the bar. And it's so brief, but that little moment I thought went to go serve the conflict and tension that was happening with Joel and Ellie of how she doesn't want him to protect him. Like it wasn't about being gay necessarily. Like that's how the conversation started, but it was really all about Joel stepping in. And Abby, like, I don't know. Does she have the average body type? No. But it's not, there's also a lot of women who do have that, who are like bodybuilders and shit, you know? Exactly. So, you know, and I don't think if it was like trying to make it all about that and really, you know, like pander, I think we would feel that. And I think a lot of people who think it's a pandering situation haven't even played the game. I can't say everyone thinks that who's played the game, that they don't think it's pandering. But I think a lot of the argument towards it being a woke agenda is haven't really picked it up yet. So yeah, I mean, but Drew, what do you think?
Yeah.
I thought like they introduced a lot of stuff randomly, and I didn't have an issue with any of it. And I was like, oh, okay, all right. And they kept bringing up certain things over and over and over again. I'm like, oh, okay, all right, all right. I don't think it was pandering. I just think they really wanted you to know that, like, you know,
we're inclusive.
We accept everybody. We accept everybody. See, and yeah. Stuff like
really?
That.
But, huh. I did not get that. I just thought it was there, you know? Like,
there were certain things that were definitely just there, and like they, you know, they glossed over it and just moved on. Yeah. And there were certain things that they kind of like hammered down on and wanted you to know, like, you know, we accept.
But like, do you,
okay. For example, I have a
challenging question, like an emotional one then, or mental one. Mm-hmm. Does it only call, do you notice it, like this whole idea of like inclusivity and all that? Do you notice it only because we're not used to seeing that amount of diversity, inclusivity in a game per se? Like, do you get what I'm saying? Do you get the question I'm asking?
Kind of. I mean, I don't think another game has really dealt with the stuff that this game does. So probably, maybe it's new, but it's like when things are mentioned like more than three times that you started to pick up on it. And, you know, I just noticed that a couple times in the game.
Fair enough.
Like, I'm just curious, Drew, like what? What exactly?
I mean, like the stuff with Lev, like the first time it's mentioned, it's like really, really quick. Like it's really quick, and it's something that is so fast you could miss it, and they just move on. Like Lev even says, "You want me to talk about it?" And she's like, "Not if you want to, but you don't have to." And then they just move on. But then it's brought up again and again and again, and it's like, okay, all right, now I see what you're trying to do. Is it bad? No, it's just like they want you to know, which, you know, is one of those things.
Hmm, I see. Okay. Let's. One thing I did.
Okay. Sorry. Can I ask a question? Is it bad though if they're trying to?
No, it's not bad.
Yeah,
it's not bad. Unless they.
I'm trying to get you canceled right now, Drew. That's what I'm trying to do.
You can't cancel me. I'm black. You can't cancel
I'm trying to get you to say the wrong thing right now.
No, it's like showing awareness is never a bad thing. It's only bad if you're sitting there with billboards, like, no, we accept everybody, see, and then yeah. they go overboard with it to the point where you know, it's like, okay, come on now.
Yeah, it's pandering.
Now it's too much.
I get you.
It didn't do that.
I see. I'm trying to bring up that one thing. I need a moment real quick to find it. Or actually, JVS, if you're still watching, could you direct message me real quick on that storyline about Ellie that I wanted to talk about? I appreciate that. LeBron James Vickers with the $25 super chat, 30% going to YouTube. Love you guys so much.
And the other 30% going to us.
Love you guys so much and really wish they didn't set the bar too high in the first games. This game really let me down story-wise. I mean, that's,
amen.
You know, and I think that's the cool thing is that we can all agree to understand each other's thought process here. Like I really wanted to understand why Drew hated that story. I don't agree with him, but I guess I can kind of understand a little bit more why it just the flow didn't go with him. You never got on board with that particular this story here. And for me, and the closest thing I can think of for me with the same example is BVS. Batman v Superman, the greatest comic book movie of all time to some people, but not me. Just the fact that that's that one moment, that one particular story-changing device of having Batman be a killer, I could never get into the rest of the story. It didn't matter how much they tried to redeem him in two to three fucking movies, apparently. It didn't matter how long they were trying to redeem him. What's done is done, and you've completely changed the arc of the I could never get on board with it. So for that, I understand Drew's opinion about the Last of Us story. So, yeah, I get it. I'm still looking for that.
I feel like Mai's like in the middle ground.
Like, but she still sides with me for a couple things.
So yeah, exactly. Yeah, like, no, I don't like Abby, but I really love the game. Like, I find that to be like that's a fascinating opinion.
That's a win for me.
Yeah.
I think it's just because like people are being very critical on this game, and I enjoyed the game for what it was. And I mean, there were parts of the story that I didn't agree with, but had it had gone how everyone wanted, right, then it's too predictable.
Exactly. I agree with that as well.
And then how are they going to make money off of us and get Last of Us 3 if they went with the story that we wanted?
And people are talking about it, though.
I wanted to talk about that, but before that, I wanted to bring this up with the chat here. This was an interesting thing that came up here about the end of The Last of Us. I'll read it to you guys right now. Crazy thing is, I truly believe Ellie did have a happy ending. We just missed the clues. Another YouTuber commented on the letter you find at the farm when you are with Dina and the baby. It's from the baby's father's mom saying that they will always have a place in Jackson if they choose to come back home. Also, if you notice, when Ellie leaves to fight Abby at the inn, she's not wearing the bracelet Dina gave her. But when she returns, the camera zooms in on one hand, on her hand, and we were focused on the fingers missing, but looked completely past the fact that now she was wearing the bracelet, possibly meaning that she has already been to Jackson and is living with Dina, and she just went back to the farm for the guitar, but decided to leave it. That represents her finally being able to accept Joel's death and the end of the cycle of revenge. And then here's some more things to back to this claim. When she comes back to the farm, she's not hurt, or she wearing any of her weapons. She doesn't seem surprised that everyone is gone when she enters the house. She doesn't call out Dina's name or anything. So I think so many people were caught up in revenge that they missed all these details. There you go. Like, what do we think?
I mean, it's possible, but I still lost two fingers, can't play the guitar, so
I like to believe that that's true because makes me feel better.
It feels like one of those reaches where like the story's depressing, so I got to find a way to make it happy. Like, the this and that, and it's like making up your own ending because you're not satisfied with how it ended.
I see. I mean, I particularly love the fact that she can't even play the same song that Joel taught her to play on the guitar, and that the first lyrics is like, "If I lose you, I lose a piece of myself."
You really like depressing shit, huh? You really like depressing shit.
I love it. I'm playing
this song. Not me.
There's a fascinating thing about this game to me is that if it was just a show or a movie, not a game, if it wasn't in this medium, I might have hated this. That's the funny thing. It's like I might have hated this because it would just be this like extremely dour, morbid experience. But I think the gameplay, like the scenes are not fun, but the gameplay I think is so fun that I have a fun time playing the game in spite of the fact that all the cutscenes are generally pretty heavy and depressing. Mm. And so if this was just a show or movie, I might have been like, it's nothing but a bunch of morbidness. But because it's a game, I feel this like strange balance of, but when I'm playing the game, I'm having a lot of fun.
That's strange because I feel the opposite. I feel like if this was like a Netflix show or something like that, I would have accepted it better than, you know, in game form because I'm not playing it. I'm not forced to play this character. I'm just like watching it and watching this, you know, this story be told and not be forced to, you know.
How are we friends, Drew? How are we friends?
I don't know. I try to figure that out every day.
I'm in this circle.
Coming soon, HBO Max. I'm casting Brie Larson as Abby. You're going to love it.
Jesus.
Tyrone's going to love that. Yeah.
We should get Tyrone Magnus in the quartering on here. that'd be the best stream.
But I'm telling you, like, you know, a lot of people are asking me to watch. You know, I only watched the Real Rejects review and Girlfriend reviews, which I thought was beautifully done. People asked me to look at Angry Joe's review, I took one look at his reaction toward the end, and you know, he slumped over in his chair, looked like somebody killed his dog or something. I'm like, all right, I already know where this is going. So it is what it is. It is what it is. LeBron James Vicker, thank you so much for that super donation. It looks like I'm going to have to break off some commissions here for my Greg and Drew. I couldn't do it alone, so we're making this happen. Let's talk about the future, guys. Last of Us prequel, sequel. What would you guys like to see? I would love both. I'd love to see a prequel myself. I'd love to see Joel in that 20-year gap of him being a smuggler, him doing crazy shit, having sex on top of with Tess while the clickers are watching. I would love to see all that. It would be great. Sequel-wise, thank you for your enthusiastic support there. sequel-wise, I would love to see Ellie on the search for the cure. I would love to see her run up against some other people. I would love to see Ellie meet people that apparently also are immune and get some sort of closure to that situation. I'd love to see her go up to Silicon Valley, maybe, since we're on the West Coast or so. Head up to Silicon Valley, maybe find some doctors that have been trying to work on a cure. And then she finds out that Joel made the right decision because there is no cure.
Or she finds an app in Silicon Valley that can tell you when there's an infected nearby.
That's perfect. That's yeah, or a ring, or whatever. And then Abby with Catalina as well. I would love to see something with that. I would love to see, essentially, it's a little cliche-ish, but you know, the Rattlers. I think that's what their name was. Yeah. The Rattlers. The Rattlers.
Fat girl.
Fat girl.
The Rattlers coming back. And then Abby and Ellie somehow teaming up with the Fireflies on Catalina Island and rolling out and doing something like that. I would love to see them come to some sort of agreement as well. But I'd be down for both of those. Mai, what do you think? Prequel, sequel? I mean, are you still down with the franchise or what?
I mean, I would be down for a prequel. I think that sounds good. If the sequel is just going it to be just Lev and Abby's journey, I don't know if I'd be too hyped to play that.
Okay.
But because I'm already so invested, it's kind of like Game of Thrones, right? Where you're invested for 7-8 seasons, and even though you hated the ending, you're like, well, I'm already invested so much time, I'll just play it anyway. A prequel would be good if they just made Abby's section maybe some DLC. I think that'd be a good idea. People want to play it, they don't have to.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
The Last Jedi. What was the Asian girl's name in The Last Jedi?
Rose Tico.
Rose. You're trying to DLC a Rose here. I see. Oh, man. Wow. I see. Okay. Greg?
They should just remake The Last of Us 2. Is there a fucking petition already?
Oh yeah, 50,000 signatures. Just sign it. They'll make it. I believe they'll actually make it. They're not remaking it.
And then, oh my god, no, let's not go there.
I will nag this next video. Remaking? Are they remaking? I love it.
No, I think. Sorry, that's just so silly.
To give you back, that's our friend. He has almost 2 million subscribers, but he hasn't played the game, but he loves talking about The Last of Us.
Really?
So we just find it pretty.
You guys are talking about?
The what?
Is it the Tyrone guy you guys were talking about?
Yeah, Tyrone Magnus. Yeah, oh, yeah.
Okay. You haven't heard of the Magnus? You haven't heard of
He's a good friend of ours. I've talked to him privately about this whole situation. He enjoys making videos, so more power to him. We just find it hilarious that he hasn't played the game, but he makes more videos about it than
I personally would love a sequel to the game where you do play as Ellie. Like I'm as much as I'm seem to be the one in the chat who's like the most on board with Abby or was able to warm up to her enough. I wouldn't want a game. I feel like Abby's story is done. I'm like, I don't need another Abby story. I don't. And
DLC.
I've heard, yeah, if maybe. it'd be cool. And as much as I respect the this theory that you were presenting of like how Ellie might have actually had a happy ending. I respect the world of The Last of Us. I respect its commitment to the bleakness of it, and that in a world like this, people are most likely going to have a pretty bleak ending. I would like a little bit of that audience cathartic feeling, though, because as much as I warmed up to Abby, I love Ellie. Ellie is like the character I just fucking love, and I prefer playing as her every step of the way. And I would like for her to have some kind of happy ending.
Thank you. We can agree on that.
As much as there might be antithesis to the world of The Last of Us, I want Ellie to have a happy ending. I'm like, come on, just give it to her. We've played with this girl for so long.
That's why I suggest the search for the cure, and then she finds out there is no cure, and they already did test. She found other people immune to her, because I do believe there is something special about Ellie and the fact that there is, you know, she's been immune, and but this is going nowhere with that particular right. situation. So I do feel like she needs closure for that. And I think that, again, finding out that she does find other people immune and they can't make a cure based on it would give her some closure with Joel as well.
Yeah. And just bring Joel back. Why not? Just
fucking do it. I honestly thought that was going to happen throughout the game. I thought he was just going to show up and be like a spiritual advisor or something like that.
I thought Ned Stark was going to return the first four seasons of Game of Thrones.
I did too. I did too.
It's really like, there's no way. He's going to come back as like a wolf or something, right? Yeah, like, I really thought that.
Drew, you loved the game so much. You did two, even after beating the game, you did two 10-hour streams on Twitch talking about it. You loved it so much. Prequel, sequel, would you play A Last of Us Part 3?
Okay, so Naughty Dog, listen up. I got a way to fix everything and make everybody happy.
Oh,
everybody.
Don't make choice.
Give us a sequel where it starts with Ellie and Dina waking up from that weed dream that they obviously went in after smoking that laced weed in that basement. Everything that happened in Last of Us 2 was a fucking fever dream. It never happened. So they wake the fuck up. Like, what the fuck happened? Shit is crazy. Don't ever smoke that again. Let's go get Joel. Yeah. Start the game like that. You can have that one for free.
And then you bring Emperor Palpatine back, and it's all great. Yeah.
It's all connected. It's all connected. Yeah. I would play that. Other than that, no.
So you're done. Are you done with the franchise? Prequel.
I don't want a prequel because I know where it ends up, and that's gonna be the primary thing in my mind. Like, I don't want to be happy playing as Joel. Like, but you know what happens in the future, so that's gonna be a downer for me. So no,
I have you on record today saying if they announce another Last of Us game, you will not play it.
I won't want to play it, but if a leak comes out, I will read it.
Okay.
And if you keep super chatting during those live streams, that
I will play. Yeah. But it's like, as it stands now, I'm not gonna play it. That may or may not change if they do it, but I highly doubt that they ever will. But
okay,
I'll say no, I won't play it.
I got a question for I'll start with Mai actually, because LeBron's comment has been here for like 20 minutes.
And we're I don't want to take it out.
And I got a question. I want to start with Mai on this one. What if Joel, like, let's say Abby kills Joel, blah, blah, blah. What if, because my main issue that when it occurred, and I would say I still have a gripe with it, actually, if I'm being totally honest. I hate the way he died, and it makes sense within the story and all that, yada, yada, yada.
I love that.
What if he did have a bit more of a heroic death or a more of a dramatic death that wasn't just like fucking shoot you in the shit and beat you with a god? What if it was something that was like a more impactful, something that's a little bit more dramatized movie style?
Like the way Logan died.
Yeah, something, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, something that's a little bit more, not just going out like, fuck you, you know?
I think that the hurt definitely would have hit differently.
Yeah.
Because then you would have felt like, okay, at least he fought for his life, right?
Right, right.
So, yeah. I mean, I agree with LeBron in that sense where similar to The Walking Dead again, where it's like when you see, you know, the way that Glenn died, right? So watching the way that Joel died was just so inhumane and just so disgusting that when I mourned that scene, oh my God, it makes me want to cry thinking about it. Like when I mourned that scene, it was just like so horrific.
That was the point though, no?
Yeah.
But he, I mean, it's like, yeah, Glenn gets the shit beat out of him, but he also still has a little bit of a moment where he gets to look at Maggie. Yeah. It's at least Margaret. Say like Maggie to her. Yeah. But then they also had, we already had that fake out moment with Glenn under the fucking garbage truck. we got to experience that.
So. But actually, that's, you know what? That's a very good comparison because we had a fake out moment with Joel in the first game. That is actually very interesting.
That's satisfactory. But Drew, what about you? If Joel had a more, I don't know what the word is I'm looking for, romanticized death. I'm not sure what it is.
Yeah. Heroic.
The thing is, like, we all knew Joel was gonna die, and him dying, we didn't like it, but we forced ourselves to accept it. It was kind of bullshit the way it happened. I don't like it, but I just made myself be okay with it because I'm like, it'll further the plot. If he had a better death, that had made the whole game better for me. If he had a death worthy of that character, like you think about everything that he went through in the first game, like you played this character, you get to know him, you experience everything with him, full immersion. Like I was, me and Joel were on the same journey. He deserved better. And if he got that, I'd have been fine with it. I that would have been a beautiful death.
Man, okay. I keep wondering like how much of a difference this game would have impacted people if Joel had he still could have died. He probably still could have died at the hands of Abby.
Mm-hmm. I probably wouldn't have hated Abby as much.
Exactly. Right. Isn't that fascinating? That's so, I just think that's so interesting.
It's just one tweak, one change they could have made that would have made everything better.
Because I feel both sides on this. I feel both sides. One side is like, well, that's the way Abby would do it. That's her story. And then the other side is, that's kind of a fucked up insult to the audience of how they killed Joel. Like, I feel both on that pretty strongly.
And then the spin on them too. It's like,
That's what I mean. It's like, it's fucked up and makes sense within the Abby storyline.
That's from what the audience
perspective. But within the audience perspective, even sitting here right now as someone who's a defender of the game, it does annoy me and piss me off a lot. Like I'm actually leaning more towards Drew and Mai here. Yeah.
If you played Last of Us when it came out 7 years ago and you have that, you're waiting for part two and you can't wait to get into it. You love these characters. Like, cause Akasan, you just played it. So you don't understand what we're going through right now.
No, but I do understand. But
7 years ago, 7 years ago, 7 years of anticipation. Yeah, it's like, you can't wait to see this. Mm-hmm. And then that happens, and they spit on them. It's like, fuck you.
Yeah.
Fuck you.
I agree with that. I agree.
Yeah. And also, like, the very end when, I mean, I know Joel was a total hard ass, but the fact that he couldn't even let out a little, like, I care about you or something, in that very last scene that he had with Ellie, like, I was just sitting there, like, come on, just be like, I love you, or I know, have some sort of tender moment. And then, you know, they just never had that closure.
But that's the whole point, though. I mean, that's the whole thing is the fact that we are, unfortunately, in a realistic world, and I know this from experience, and I'm sure a lot of you guys have known this, when somebody is taken away from you, there is no planned heroic sort of setup. It's like, all right, I'm out now. It's usually just a shock. And when somebody is killed, if somebody is taken away from you, someone you love is taken away from you, it usually comes at a shock. You'll always remember that phone call, and you will always remember the last moments you had with that person. Mm. And for this particular story, that's exactly what the point is supposed to be. As Greg mentioned earlier, you're supposed to be angry. You're supposed to be upset. You're supposed to wonder, who the fuck are these people? I'm ready to kill them. I'm ready to murder them with my bare hands. And as you go through this revenge story type of deal, things start to change. And if they had given Joel this kind of heroic death, then it would have been even harder to try to introduce something different and something unique to the storytelling of the game. Personally, the way I've always seen this game, this series, as someone, as Drew mentioned, I'm newer to this franchise, but the way I've always seen it is this has always been, the main focus has always been on Ellie. Joel is a catalyst. Yeah, you play as Joel, But the whole point of the story is Ellie, the woman with the cure type of deal. When promotional stuff started coming out, all I saw was Ellie. And I'm like, okay, cool. So I'm just going to play as Ellie. It's going to be a game about Ellie. And I was fine with that. So them taking out Joel, yeah, it was sad. But at the same time, I love the fact that they made you question, am I missing some context here? Who are these people? Why are Joel and Ellie, why are they mad at each other? And it's that last scene at the end that is just so touching to realize that they never really repaired anything, and they were going to try to, but they never got that chance. And the next day or a day after that, Joel was killed. I thought that was great. So, but you know, that's, I guess that's the dark side storytelling I like. So,
So Mai, you would have wanted a verbal thing that, like, him to actually, because what made me cry in that final scene with Joel and Ellie is when she's saying something like I do love that flashback, because
it's beautiful.
She's saying, I forget the exact dialogue where he's like, I want you to about forgiving. And then he says,
I don't know if I can ever forgive you.
Yeah.
But I'm willing to try.
What made me cry was when Joel, you could see him tearing up.
Yes.
And he's like, I think he says, I would like that. And
I would like that.
Yeah. What that moment. It's like, you know, Joel loves Ellie, you know, these things, and you know that, like how you said, like, he's a hard ass and he's not the best at being vulnerable or expressing himself. But you're saying it would have done something more for you if he had verbally said something like actually said it out loud.
Yeah, because they never really got further in that. Right. So that's why, you know, I understand Ellie's path and, you know, wanting to end this whole circle of revenge, right? But then if anything, like, doesn't that make you a little bit more pissed off? Because you're like, oh, now I never got, you know, closure with the guy who essentially became my dad. And you took that away from me. So, I know. I know it's kind of, you know, going on both sides here, but because I like the game for what it was, but there's just so many little tweaks and things that, you know, you wish it could have gone that way. But then at the same time, right, like, that is life. Life never goes the way that you want it to, right?
I mean, it's about setting them on paths. I think that's what the ending is saying. Is like, this is the path to forgiveness. That, like, with Joel and Ellie, like, that is saying, they're starting the path to forgiveness. And then by the end of the game, she has reached forgiveness. And I think that's what it was trying to say, like, correlate that. But I also wanted
a tender moment.
Yeah, no, I get what you're getting at there.
I think the reason why I didn't really need that clarified is because you got these beautiful flashback scenes, like the one at the museum, where that is pretty much said without being said. Like,
right.
You see everything, their interactions, especially that whole astronaut scene going to space. That was the best part of the game to me, hands down. And that right there pretty much said, I love you, without saying I love you. Like, that said everything that needed to be said right then and there. That's why I didn't really need, you know, verbal confirmation, because you knew, he knew, she knew, and you got these beautiful flashback scenes. The flashback should have been the whole game, but, you know, that's another story.
I think that's where traditional men and women differ a little bit, right? Like, the guy's like, oh, see, like, I showed you I loved you.
Look at my actions.
Like, oh, like, I want you to tell me that you love me.
Fair enough. Yeah.
All right,
you should know.
Stuff I did, you know.
You should know.
Exactly. You never said anything. It makes sense. Well, I gave you flowers. That's not telling me.
It makes sense.
It is a beautiful ending. That flashback. For me, I think the dinosaur museum flashback is great. But if you also think about it, it parallels with Abby going to the aquarium for the first time as well, which I thought was really cool. The parallels of that. I think both Abby and Ellie do a dive into water and such type of flashback. So I think that I think this storytelling was, to me, it was brilliant, and it's never been done before in a AAA game, and it's a very unconventional storytelling, very Tarantino-ish. David Finch, right? Girl with the dragon tattoo.
Dave Fincher.
Thank you. Yeah. Type of storytelling that really makes you think about this and really thinks about all the gray matter here. So no, I love it. I love it.
If we turn the subtitles off, we can just do the I love you dialogue for
you. There you go. Perfect. It's perfect. Go ahead. You can meet Ellie right here.
Oh, no.
Ellie, I love you so much. You're my favorite, Ellie.
Yes, kiddo. Come on, do it right.
I know my voice is
I'll do Ellie. Hold on a second.
Oh God, I'm out.
Here we go. This is gonna be great.
I just want you to. Stupid. You're not stupid. I love you. I love you so much, Ellie. We should just redub this whole scene and then send it to my.
Here, Let me see. I'll do Ellie right here. Hold on. And then we're going to wrap. You're such an asshole.
An asshole that loves you, Ellie.
I was supposed to die in that hospital.
Well, I'm about to get shot in the shin like a bitch, honestly.
My life would have fucking mattered, but you took that from me.
Don't worry, this game's gonna treat me like my life didn't matter 5 minutes from now.
It's funny because it's true.
And then I think this is the last part here. Look at the pain. And I love you guys, you gotta love the acting and the voice acting here.
Yeah, it was great.
This was great.
I even love Abby's voice acting. It was amazing. Like, it was believable.
I thought you sent all those death threats to her.
I didn't do it. I told people not to do it.
I saw your name in there.
Oh, shit. Did I pause it? Oh, okay. Yeah. And then here's the last part. I don't know if I would have. Yeah. This was great. Yeah, it's a lot longer than I remember.
It's too long. That's my main criticism. It's too long.
True comment. True. I just. What? I don't think I can ever forgive you for that.
I'm glad this discussion did not turn into us ganging up on Drew.
Yeah, thank you. I'm like 3-on-1. What the hell is this?
Look at her face. Look at that face of a broken, both of them. Honestly, I thought if this doesn't get Game of the Year.
No, it's not getting Game of the Year.
Oh my God. I can't imagine anything else that would get Game of the Year.
Final Fantasy VII Remake.
Oh, hell no.
Hell no. What? Are you kidding
me? Hell no.
Dad, never fight over that.
Hell no. I'm going to turn one game into 3 games and get Game of the Year. I'll see you around. Yep. All right.
Yes. There God damn go. It, just hug.
Someone should reanimate it for you. I feel like people will be capable of doing that, right?
You know what?
Someone hit up Aldo Jones. He can do it.
Final
comments, guys. Let's just go around to anything else, anything you want to say here. We're wrapping up here. Anything else?
Yeah, I'll end it with Laura Bailey did not write the character. Yeah. She did not mocap for the character. The character is not modeled after her. Mm-hmm. It's a video game. She did a voiceover job. Why are you being stupid and blaming her? Don't. If you don't like it, you got some other. If you're gonna send death threats, that says something about you, not about her. So stop doing it. You're being a dumbass. Mm-hmm.
For reals. I can agree. Reals. My.
I think people have been taking the game too seriously, and they just need to enjoy it for what it is.
Oh, so good. So well said. So well said.
True.
This is a game that I waited 7 years for. I really wanted to like it. I loved everything except for the story. I'm glad some people do like it. And
some.
Yeah. I mean, in my circle and people I've talked to, some people like it. I've only talked to 3 other than, you know, the 3 of you.
And that is the sum total of everyone who has played the game.
I've talked to over 50 people that hated it passionately. I've talked to people have called me up that I haven't talked to in over 10 years complaining about the game. I'm like, so it's pretty massive, but I'm glad some people like it. And it started a lot of discussion, which is good. I don't know if all the press is good press, but regardless of the story, it's an amazing game. They've done stuff with this game that no other game has ever done. And it's going to be talked about for a long time. And I did have fun playing it for at least half of my playthrough. And it's a game that I will say, if you haven't played it, at least try it out and come up to that conclusion for yourself, whether you don't like it or you like it. But don't don't say you don't like it if you haven't played it. That's all I'll say. At least play the game. At least play the game first, and then you can judge it. If you haven't played it and you just read the leaks, you can't really judge it. That's all I'm going to say, and I'm going to leave it at that.
Nice.
Okay. Well said. Well said. I agree. In my time of playing games or doing discussions or what have you not on YouTube, I don't think there's ever been a game. There's damn near not even movies that get as much discussion, as much controversy as this particular game, for good or bad. But the thing that I'm so happy about is the fact that we can all come together and have an open discussion likes this, and very similar to Civil War, I guess, the Marvel movie, not the actual war. You can actually have a conversation and a debate here and not really have an absolute right answer or wrong answer, but we can all have different opinions as to how this game should have been, what it could have been, or why we liked what it was. And I think that's a true testament to how impactful this game was. Not just the fact that the first game was the highest selling PlayStation game of all time. I think this game on its own is getting people to come in here and talk about real life choices and how the choices that we make in the real world and in our lives affect what will happen to other people. And as the thread goes on and on and on. So I like the fact that we can all sit here and start reflecting about the people that we've had in our lives and the choices we made, and of course, the people that we have lost, and the especially now with the corona situation, being in quarantine, we have time to think about the choices we made and the reflections, reflect upon those choices, and hope that we don't find ourselves in the same situation as Ellie or Abby or even Joel for that matter. So I'm glad that we were able to sit down here and have that conversation with all of you guys. Games for the future. For me, it's Ghost of Tsushima coming up next. I'm playing Persona right now. I got the recommendation from Mai. I'm on Persona right now. A fan bought me.
Wait, did you even finish Part 4 Golden yet?
Well, I started it, and then I started it, and then a fan bought me Persona 5, and so
Who's your wife so far?
I haven't gotten to the wife. We can have wife.
Well, but you could. You see the girl when you first meet her, and then you could be like, "Ooh, that's the one."
Come on, Mai. You know who I? You know who I'm talking about? The Japanese girl, the blonde hair. I'm in with it. Forgot her name now, but yeah.
Yeah,
I think so. Yeah. I'm down with that. The Catwoman of the game. Yeah. So that's all me until Tsushima comes out. So I'm down with that. Drew?
Ghost of Tsushima, Cyberpunk, a few other indie titles. But yeah, rest of the year is looking nice.
Greg, are you doing a lot of the games here or what?
I've been catching up very slowly. So slow. So slowly. Yeah, Ghost of Tsushima for sure. I got the PS4 originally just to play Red Dead 2, and I am nowhere near. Oh my god!
You also cry in that game.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna start over because I forgot everything. I was worried about the stream because I was like, "Fuck, I forget games so fast. what happened in this game again?" So yeah, and I feel like for Red Dead, I should probably start that again. But now Ghost of Tsushima is the main one. Cyberpunk, of course. Mm-hmm. I hear they're probably going to announce a new Batman. I'm trying to catch up on all the Batman games. I hear a DC fandom, they might be announcing a new Batman game. So I'm trying to, and I'm halfway through Jedi Fallen Order. I'm just like,
oh, great game.
I'm a mixed bag of everything right now. I'm just like hopping around so much. I started Uncharted 3 as well. So I'm just trying to like knock out all these games at once.
And also a current or former member of the Real Rejects, Brianna. She actually did the voice of, somebody help me. Final Fantasy.
Aerith.
Long girl.
Yeah.
I just found that out like a month ago. I'm like, wait, what?
Yeah. She texted me about it. She's like, it's a secret. And I was like, that's crazy. And then when the game came out, I was like, I didn't realize it was this crazy because I never played Final Fantasy. And I'm like, shit. Yeah, she's like, famous now. What the fuck's going on?
That's big. Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah. The Real Rejects get breaking into the Final Fantasy lore.
She's killing it right now. She lives like an hour away or something, but she's killing it. I'm so happy. I've never since I was like fucking 16 or something like that. So,
wow.
Yeah, she's killing it.
That's awesome, man. That's awesome.
I got to credit Mai too for this experience because I feel like she's cut the fact that it's like the three of us the guys here all know each other. She's the only woman in this chat. And there's like three dudes who are like, we're all friends. We know each other. And then she's just meeting us two for the first time. And I'm like, no, she, I loved everything you had to say, Mai. I thought everything
I have been in isolation for several months. It's nice to make new friends.
Yeah, no, dude, like you did fucking great today. So
Mai and I have had talks about this, and she's doing our best. As you guys both know, it's very hard to balance real life, especially a career life, a real career life, and then balance an online presence. Mm-hmm. So she's doing her best, and I really appreciate the fact
that just read all the comments all the time.
Respond to every single comment individually.
Get your self-worth from what other people are saying about you, and you'll be solid. It's really easy like that.
What is the next game for you, Mai? What?
So for me, next game, same as everyone here, Ghost of Tsushima. That's going to be the next one I play. Currently, I'm playing Trails of Cold Steel 3 on the Switch because I never got it on the PlayStation. Wow. Persona 4, I got that on Steam, so I'll be playing that since I already finished 5. But I also need to finish 5R, which I have not finished yet. And then also just Animal Crossing on the daily.
That's the same. Okay. If you guys want to check out Mai, you can check out her Twitch channel primarily, but she is also on Twitter as well. I will link it in the description after the stream is over and such, but it's essentially, I believe, Mai_Chu, if I'm correct. Yeah,
double underscore like this. You know how girls like to go like this? So that's why I did that.
Really annoying.
I was like, Mai Chu.
I legit sent like 20 people your way on in a raid, and it ended up being a different channel altogether, and I was like, oh.
But then see, now you can never forget my username, because you know it's going to be Mai double underscore
Chu. Underscore Chu, yeah. That, we're going to have to talk about brand here. Greg Alba, of course, the Real Rejects. You can check him at him and John. John's the new name, right? New old name, right?
Yeah.
I always want to say Jerry, but John, Greg and John, the Real Rejects, among other different people that pop up from time to time. They give huge critiques, great critiques on essentially films. And then every week you're doing live streams now, right?
Yeah, I mean, we're fucking quarantined.
Finally.
And, I've been like, oh shit, these are so fun. I love them. I think they're so fun. Very fun. Go check out my video. I rarely plug a specific video ever in my life, but I did a video recently.
Let me see if I can find
it. Called Disney Buys the Rights to the Bible.
I can't wait to check that out.
Yeah. Go check it out. I think it's a wonderful satire. I'm going to credit myself. Yeah.
There it is. Right under the Boys season 2 trailer reaction. Right. Oh, no. Actually, sorry.
Children were scared by real ghosts. Oh, not that.
Those are just reaction videos. This is good. I don't know.
Oh, there it is.
Okay, Disney buys the rights.
Okay. No, it's not blackface. Just a very black.
I talk about blackface in it. I do.
Okay. Well, there you go.
Go check it out.
Okay. And of course, streaming daily every day and loving The Last of Us. Make sure you check out Drew with Struggle Nation on Twitch. Yep. Primarily on Twitch for all the gameplay, but there's also YouTube as well.
Twitch and YouTube. I stream on both every day.
Watch out, man. You don't get that ban hammer. You know, if they're going to kick off Dr. Disrespect, they'll be coming after you.
We don't know what they kicked them off for, so we don't know.
Yeah, we still don't know, right?
Yeah, we don't know. Yeah.
Wait, did Brie Larson subscribe to my channel? No way. Get out of here. We'll see. Okay. I'm just wondering. She's coming for that reactor money. And and then of course him and Joe actually do reactions every once in a while when they can. And but that
every day.
Not... Oh, really? So busy.
Every day.
Really?
Yeah. I upload every day, every single day.
Oh, you upload it, really?
Mm-hmm.
And you still get reaction requests. That's the easiest thing. That's life. Well, all right, guys. So I appreciate everybody for today, and especially the fans. This is probably a new number here. About 400, 500 people we had watching at one point in time. So, and they agreed with everything we said, and there were no hateful comments at all. I appreciate it, guys, and I love you all, and I guess we'll see you guys for the next big video game chat.
Hell yeah.
We're out of here. Thanks, guys. We're out.
Thank you, guys. This was fun. Thanks.
And